преди секунди си свалих вратовръзката, защото в обществото на толкова млади, хубави и умни хора просто се чувствам като чук, извинявам се, и затова свалих вратовръзката. Второто събитие, което е организирано от глобалната мрежа Millennium, има за цел да представи с помощта на доктор Хосе Кордейро технологиите на бъдещето. Кой всъщност е Millennium Project България? Millennium Project България е създаден от Мариана Тодорова, доктор Мариана Тодорова. Тя е доктор по футурология. Миналата година в щатите на Световната конференция на футуролозите представи нейния начин за прогнозиране на бъдещето, наречен контрафактичен анализ. И сега ще има публикация съвсем скоро на пейпер за контрафактичен анализ в Библията на футуролозите. Кой съм аз? Аз съм доктор Боян Иванчев, съосновател, любимия на Мариана все още. И се занимавам с поведенчески финанси и невроекономика. Оттам насетне, след тази втора лекция и второ събитие, имаме идеи да представим бъдещето на различни сектори. Твърде вероятно един от секторите ще бъде бъдещето на банковата индустрия, бъдещето на парите, бъдещето на медиите. Мариана, заповядай да представиш Millennium по-добре.
Благодаря. Аз ще направя дългия разказ и само няколко неща ще ви кажа. Първо, много се радвам да ви видя. Наистина, само като погледна аудиторията и се чувствам много щастлива и вдъхновена. И затова решихме да представим и Millennium Project тук в България, защото до много скоро новините за бъдещето, за технологиите, за развитието идваха при нас само като някакво далечно ехо и винаги се чувстваме в периферията. Нямаме достатъчно самочувствие, нямаме достатъчно увереност. Аз познавам толкова много брилянтни хора и искам те да се чувстват добре на мястото си, където са с това, което правят. Защо решихме да представляваме Millennium Project? Защото за поредна година той е обявен за шестия най-приятелен think tank в света по нови идеи, парадигми, така че смятаме, че си струва той да бъде представен. Той прави през всяка година или през две години един доклад, който се нарича State of the Future. Ние го преведохме като човешкото бъдеще в хоризонта на развитие. В него има 15 индекса, които показват основните възможности и заплахи пред човечеството, дават се насоки за развитие, перспективи, искахме и българската публика да бъде в част, така че имаме вече преведена книга. Ще се занимаваме с много научни проекти, но и много прагматични, дадем много подобни лектори в различни сфери, не само за технологиите. Наистина, за да отворим дебата за бъдещето, да поставим България на картата на бъдещето и да създадем една общност, с която надявам се заедно с вас да водим дебата за бъдещето. Не да сме приклещени в миналото, да изравяме някакви стари стили гардероба и около това да се върти нашата политика, нашата икономика и така нататък. Ще правим много сценарии, прогнози, ще проследяваме трендове, ще подпомагаме секторите, които са иновативни и са част от глобалните медиатрендове. Ще посочваме и тези, които са на път да изчезнат, както Хосе днес по-рано каза, че банкирането е на път от мрежа в формата, която съществува, така че тепърво още предстои да чувате новини от вас. Аз за първи път чух Хосе в Орландо и когато го слушах, казах, тук доминира явно технологичния абсолютизъм, защото се говореше с невероятен позитивизъм за всички технологични промени, които ни очакват. Още повече, че заедно с Конгреса на футуролозите течеше паралелно и Конгреса на научните фантастики. И така, има едно опиянение, един безкрайен оптимизъм. Всъщност, по-късно, като ми се поохладиха страстите, разбрах, че всъщност ние гледаме на развитието на технологиите еволюционистки. Ние приемаме това като част от нашата еволюция, защото тя не е свършила. И това е един пореден етап, който ни предстои, който ще ни се случи. Разбира се, технологията, науката са неутрални, само че ние им придаваме съответните нюанси, добри и лоши. Явно ние трябва да изживеем лошите, за да стигнем до добрите. Но аз се питам, и това е основният ми въпрос към все тази вечер. Можем ли да преживеем тази технологична сингулярност, това единение с изкуствения интелект и с технологиите по начин, който не е еволюционистски, а да направим един експоненциален скок, така че да не търпим някакви негативни последици от технологиите и да можем наистина само да се възползваме. Сега давам думата на него, защото това е най-интересната и съществената част, но преди да я давам, искам да благодаря специално на Бяла Крака за финансовата помощ и благодарение на което ние реализираме това събитие, и също така специално на господин Михаил Михайлов, който е благодарен за организационната и креативна подкрепа и помощ.
Hello, good afternoon. Forgive that I will speak in English, which is also not my mother tongue. My mother tongue is Spanish, but we will communicate in a third language, in English, okay? And I want to talk about the future, because the future is going to be incredible. We are living the most incredible time in human history. The next 20 years are going to be more fascinating than the last 200 years. We are going to see incredible changes in the next few years. I work with the Millennium Project in Latin America. I coordinate the group all over Latin America. And then also I am one of the founding faculty at Singularity University in the year 2009. The Millennium Project, we have nodes all over the world, also now here in Sofia, Bulgaria. And we cover all the 15 global challenges, the big problems of humanity towards the future, and we publish every year a book about the state of the future. That was also published just 2 months ago in Bulgarian also. And I have presented that book and other books at the World Economic Forum. Actually, I was last week in Switzerland as well. But I want to talk more about technology, and for that, in 2009, there was a new university created, sponsored by NASA and Google, in the middle of California, in Silicon Valley, and the university is called Singularity University. And it has to do about all the exponential technologies. But let me ask you first, who has heard about the technological singularity? How many of you have heard about the technological singularity? Okay, good that some of you know. Because it is a new term in a way. It's only in the last few years that it has been popularized. I teach about new energy sources, about solar energy, solar on Earth and solar in space, wind energy, geothermal energy, but all the subjects are fascinating, like medicine, neuroscience, human enhancement, artificial intelligence and robotics. For those of you who are not familiar with the singularity, a couple of years ago, the beginning of life. And as you can see, the subtitle of that article is 2045, the year man becomes immortal. And for the ladies here, also women will become immortal. All of us will become immortal between 2029 and 2045. But this is only one of the many consequences of the technological singularity. The idea was popularized by a good friend of mine, also from MIT, the Massachusetts Institute of Technology, which is my alma mater in Cambridge, Massachusetts. And he wrote 10 years ago the very famous book, The Singularity is Near, when he talks about what is going to happen in the next few decades. This book is recommended by Bill Gates as the best book about the future of humanity. And it has some forecasts about what is going to happen in the next few decades until 2045, which is the late year for the technological singularity. As you can see, there are some extrapolations which are based on Moore's Law. I think many of you know Moore's Law, which is based on the discovery of Gordon Moore, who was co-founder of Intel, the company that makes the chips. He discovered in the 1960s that computers double their power every 2 years, and the price was reduced every 2 years. If you look at the scale now, in fact, in the 1990s, this has been accelerated. Now computers double their power every year and a half. And soon, it will be every year, because the first generation of three-dimensional circuits is just beginning. So we are going to move into a faster rate of change, not a slower, faster. If you look at the vertical axis, it is a logarithmic scale, which implies an exponential improvement. And that is the number of transistors that computers have throughout time, and it is increasing, increasing, increasing. For those of you who are too young, you might not recognize this. These were the IBM punch cards. This is how computer programs were written and stored. This was the unit of storage, you know, 40 years ago. This basically has 10 rows times 100 columns, approximately. 10 times 100 is 1,000, so this is 1K, 1K of memory. And you had to make calls. You were all the time making little calls, because this is how you could store the information. Then, the first electromagnetic memories were invented, and they were 8 inches big. I have an example here of the first generation that was also 1K. This was 1K, but this 1K was much bigger because you could erase. This 1K electromagnetic was better. Also, it had a bigger hole. But 30 years ago, we had one mechanical K and one electromagnetic K. In Spanish, we pronounce K ka. So we had 1 ka plus 1 ka, and 1 ka plus 1 ka makes 1 kaka. We had 1 kaka of memory 30 years ago. For the young people here, this really happened. I used this 30 years ago. 1 kaka. And then, you know the incredible changes we have had in technology. We moved to these smaller memories of about 5 inches and a quarter that had up to 512 kakas. And then these ones of 1.4 mega. And today, if you go to Korea or Japan, which are the leaders on this type of USB memories, this is 128 gigabytes. 128 gigabytes. So look at what has happened in 30 years. We went from kaka to 128 gigabytes. So what do you think is going to happen in the next 30 years? This is accelerated. This is not slowing down. This is happening now faster. So in 30 years, actually in 20 years, you will remember me. And you will remember kaka. But this will be kaka in 20 years. We will have a device smaller than this and more powerful than your brain. A small device like this will have more transistors than we have neurons in our brain. And that is the beginning of the technological singularity, when we will have machines, computers, artificial intelligence, reaching the level of humans. You might think this is happening only with computers, but no, this is happening in all technologies. All technologies are changing exponentially. For example, in biotechnology. I am going to show you my human genome, the partial sequence of my genome. There are many companies doing the full sequence or the partial sequence of my genome, of the genome. This is one company called 23andMe. If you look at the top right, you will see my name, Jose Correo. My genome is actually in internet. It is all uploaded. So that if I forget my genome, you know, I just download it from internet. When you sequence your genome, and all of you will sequence your genome in 5 to 10 years, you will know all your physical characteristics. You will know the color of your eyes, if you didn't know that already, because it is in your genes. With a little device like this, which is called a chip for genes, a chip to sequence the genome, this will tell you the color of your eyes, the color of your hair. It will also tell you which diseases you are going to have, according to your genes. What is the probability that you will have Alzheimer's? What is the probability that you will have Parkinson's? That you will have diabetes? All of that is in your genes. So once you sequence your genome, you will know what you will die of. So that you do not die of that. Because in the future, medicine will no longer be curative. Medicine will be preventive. We will prevent all diseases. In the next 20 to 30 years, all diseases will be preventable. So if you don't think that that's incredible, other things you will know once you sequence your genome, you will find out where your family comes from. This is my paternal line 500 years ago. And then you can see at the bottom right, famous people related to my father, like Genghis Khan. So I am a descendant of Genghis Khan. So no one wants to fight with me. So, but this is true. Once you sequence your genome, you will know who you come from. So this is my paternal line. Let me show you my maternal line and where my mother comes from. And you can see famous people related to my mother, like Maria Antoinette. I come from a very aristocratic family between Genghis Khan and Maria Antoinette. All of you will know this. When you sequence your genome, and you will be able to reconstruct your genealogical tree, and you will be able to verify for the first time if your father is really your father. But more interesting than looking back into the past is better to look into the future. And we are going to design our children the way we want them. In fact, you are part of the last human generation who is here by mistake. All of you are here by mistake. You were not designed. In the future, we will design our children. And let me show you an experiment I did with one of my students, sharing genes. We were sharing our genes. Obviously, this is a theoretical experiment, to see the probability of different genes for our children. And you will be able to do this not only with 2 people, you can do this with 5 people. If you like the eyes of 1 person, the hair of another person, the legs of another person, my brain, etc., you will be able to mix all those genes to create the descendant that you want. Do you think this is expensive? This was incredibly expensive. The first human genome began in 1990. The sequence of the first human genome began in 1990 and it finished in 2003. It took 30 years to sequence the first human genome and it cost over $1 billion to the US government, plus $2 billion for other governments because it was an international project. Today, you can sequence your genome completely for about $950 today. Less than $1,000 in 5 days, in 1 week. We estimate, we believe that in 10 years, you will sequence your genome in 1 minute for $10. I want you to see those numbers again. The first genome costs $1 billion, and in the future it's going to be $10. The first human genome took 13 years to be sequenced. 13 years, and you will do it in 1 minute. This is absolutely incredible. This is more incredible than CACA. The changes here in biotechnology are much faster than the changes in computers. And soon, we will see the same with nanotechnology. Nanotechnology is running about 20 years behind biotechnology. But we are going to see incredible changes in biotechnology also. So, everything is changing exponentially. Technologies change exponentially. And they are becoming smaller, cheaper, better, and faster continuously. Let me explain to you the difference between linear and exponential changes. If you walk linearly, and if you make 30 steps, each step is 1 meter, after 30 steps, I have walked 30 meters. But if we walk exponentially, doubling every time, after 30 steps, you have walked 1 billion meters, and you have gone around planet Earth 26 times. This is difficult for us to understand, because we do not think exponentially. We understand 30 linear meters, but we don't understand 30 exponential steps. We cannot understand this, because our brains evolve in a linear world, but technology changes exponentially. And so you have to get ready for a world of exponential technology. And everything is changing. As, let me tell you a little bit about South America, where I grew up. We have a very famous Argentinian cartoon called Mafalda, who knows about everything. So she was asked, what is the future? And she said, well, the future is no longer what it used to be. Okay, the future is changing. Everything is changing. Companies are changing. Let me give you examples of two South American companies. Does anyone know the logo that is on the left? That is Juan Valdez, which is the symbol of Colombia. For those of you who do not know Colombia or Juan Valdez, let me explain to you. It is the Colombian farmer with a mule and with some white bags. When you explain this to people, the Colombian farmer with a mule and white bags, they think it is cocaine. But it is not cocaine, it is coffee. Colombia is one of the largest coffee producers in the world, and none of you recognize the symbol of Colombia. By the way, Colombia has 50 million people. It's not a small country, 50 million people. And none of you recognize the symbol of Colombia. But all of you recognize the Starbucks, okay? And actually the idea is that we have to move from raw materials into added value. The important thing is not coffee. The important thing is how you add value to the coffee. The Starbucks sells 10 times more than all the Colombian coffee exports. The value is not in the raw materials. The value is in adding value. To anything, to coffee, also to cocaine. It's not important just to produce the cocaine, but the distribution is where you make the money. Let me show you another example of a company that probably you don't know it, which is the largest company in South America. It's from Venezuela, PDVSA. This is Petróleos de Venezuela, Sociedad Anónima. It's the largest company in South America. And none of you know it. However, all of you know Mickey Mouse, right? I am a big fan of Mickey Mouse, if you look at my tie. And the important thing is that Mickey Mouse sells as much as all the petroleum from Venezuela. A little mouse sells as much as all the petroleum from the largest company in South America. So we need to move again from raw materials into value added. We need to move from manufacturing to mind factory. Mind factory. We need to use our minds. So that you know that I really like Mickey Mouse, I'm going to wear my Mickey Mouse hat. And so that you know that this is a serious presentation, okay? Because we are talking about the future of humanity, and this is very, very serious. So let's think about manufacturing, how we are going to add value to the industries of the future. For that, I want to explain to you the four ways to think about the future. The first one is when you are passive, like an ostrich. You hide your head, you don't want to know what is going to happen. Terrible to be passive. The second way is to be reactive, like a firefighter. You react when there is a fire, when there is an emergency. The third way is to be preactive, like when you buy insurance, you want to be prepared. But the best way is to be proactive, because you can create the future. You can design different scenarios, good scenarios and bad scenarios, and go for the good ones and avoid the bad ones, right? So I hope that there are no ostriches here, because ostriches are not from Bulgaria. But if there are ostriches, at least they should be technological ostriches, okay? That you use technology to see the future. A few years ago, I went to visit Sir Arthur C. Clarke, who was a very, very famous science fiction author. And he wrote Space Odyssey 2001, which was one of the most famous space movies at the time, and many other science fiction books. But he was also famous for science, not science fiction, real science books. And he also wrote The Three Laws of the Future. The Three Laws of the Future. First Law of the Future. When a famous scientist says that something is possible, he is probably right. But when he says it is impossible, he is probably wrong. Second Law of the Future. The only way of discovering the limits of the possible is to venture past the limits into the impossible. And the third law of the future, any sufficiently advanced technology is indistinguishable from magic. This has a corollary. If you see a technology that does not look like magic, it's because it is not advanced. So now I'm going to talk about magical technologies, things that we are going to see in the next few decades. And if we go back in time, think about 30 years ago, when computers were just beginning, or 20 years ago when mobile telephones were beginning, or 10 years ago when Google was a small company in California, and Wikipedia also, or Facebook was being born about 10 years ago. What do you think is going to happen in the next 10 years, in the next 20 years, in the next 30 years? We are going to see magic. We are going to see magical things. One of those is the control of aging. We are going to have immortal cells in the next 20 to 30 years. And this, which might sound like magic, actually is science and technology. Today, we know that aging is a disease, but it is a curable disease. We have several professors at Singularity University who work on aging. And we expect to cure aging in the next 20 to 30 years. One of these people, who is a scientist from Cambridge University in England, he created a foundation called the Methuselah Foundation to create mice, a little mouse, that is going to be immortal, or that is going to be like Methuselah, that lived 1,000 years. The advantage of doing experiments with a mouse is that a mouse lives normally 1.5 years. 1.5 years for a mouse is equivalent to 100 human years. He began doing this 10 years ago, and today he already has mice that live 5 years. 5 years is the equivalent of 300 human years. This has happened in the last 10 years. What do you think is going to happen in the next 10 years? Also, they are doing experiments with other life forms, simpler, smaller life forms like mosquitoes. With the fruit flies, the Drosophila melanogaster, they have extended the life 4 times already. and with some worms like the Sea Elegans, six times. This has all been done in the last 10 years. So think what we are going to see in the next 10 years. In fact, we already know that we have immortal cells in us. We humans, we have two types of immortal cells, the good ones and the bad ones. The germinal cells that make sperm and eggs do not age. Germinal cells do not age in any life form, not just on humans. Germinal cells do not age. That doesn't mean that they don't die, because if you kill them, or if they don't have food, or if the rest of the body dies, then they die with the rest of the body. But germinal cells do not age. And there is another very interesting type of cells that discovered how not to age, which is cancer. Cancer is probably the most fascinating disease, because it discovered how not to age. A cancer is a mutation of a normal cell that doesn't age anymore. And this is the problem of cancer, because cancer does not age. It keeps on growing, it keeps on reproducing, it keeps on eating the rest of the body, and it doesn't die. That's why you have to kill cancer, because cancer cells do not die on their own. They do not age. Cancer cells discovered how not to age. This is really incredible if you think about it. There are going to be, in the next 10 years, many Nobel Prizes on cancer research, because cancer is an incredibly interesting disease that discovered how not to age. Well, now finally people are understanding that aging is a disease, and that we should be able to cure aging in the next few years. And companies are already putting money to cure aging. Google created 2 years ago a company called Calico that appeared on the front page of Time magazine. Calico means California Life Company. And the objective of this company is to cure aging. I am convinced that in the next 20 years, maximum 30 years, we are going to cure aging. We are going to see the death of death. You heard it well, the death of death. We are going to feel death in the next 20 to 30 years. And this is not religion, this is not philosophy, this is science and technology working. We live in the most incredible times. If you survive the next 30 years, you will become part of the first human immortal generation. So you have a lot of responsibility as part of the first human immortal generation. However, it doesn't really mean you are going to be totally immortal, because you never know if you're immortal, because you might die at some point. For example, if a piano falls on my head, I will be pianized, right? Or if there is a comet that hits the earth, many people will die, even if they do not age. What we are going to control is aging. There will be no aging in the future. But that doesn't mean that we will not die. There are accidents, there are pianos, and there are comets, okay? So, talking about this only 10 years ago was crazy. People would think that you were crazy. Well, Google not only created Calico, they invested $1.5 billion. I don't know what you think about Google, but I hope that you understand that $1.5 billion is a lot of money. And this is only the beginning to cure aging. So, let me talk about the future that is so incredible. 10 years ago, the National Science Foundation and the Department of Commerce of the USA got together to talk about which technologies will change humanity. And more than change humanity, which technology will change humans. All of us are going to be changed deeply by technology. These four technologies are nano, bio, info, and photo. Nanotechnology studies the atoms, the molecules. Biotechnology studies the genes, the cells. Nano and bio are the hardware of life, the hardware of life. And info and photo are the software of life. In lympho studies beta sites and Kofnoff studies neurons, the brain. So NanoRubin and Bio, hardware. Info and Kofnoff, software. In the next 20 years, plus minus 5 years, we are going to reach the complexity of the human hardware and the complexity of the human software. And then we are going to improve on it. We are going to improve on the human hardware and on the human software in the next 20 years, plus minus 5. And this is going to the technological singularity, a convergence of technology. Let me review quickly these four technologies. Nanotechnology. Nanotechnology is making things smaller, 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 until we get to the molecular level, to atom by atom. This is engineering at perfection. You put an atom where you want the atom to be. There is no waste. There is nothing extra. And there is nothing missing or lacking. Nothing. You only put atoms where you want the atoms to be. Nanotechnology will eliminate the idea of waste. In the future, there will be no garbage, there will be no waste. There will only be raw material in the wrong place, because everything will be raw materials. With nanotechnology, and this is an example of a rotating engine, the smallest engine that you can make, each little circle is an atom of a different element, atoms of oxygen, nitrogen, calcium, sodium, and so on and so forth. And you put them in that way, and this is an engine made at perfection. At perfection. Nothing more, nothing less. With nanotechnology, there will be no garbage, there will be no waste, and our cities will be incredibly green, ecological, and incredibly advanced. It will be magic. Magic. Second technology. Biotechnology, which is living nanotechnology, nanotechnology that is alive. There are many ways and experiments and things to do with biotechnology. For example, mixing species. Today you can mix genes from one species into another. About 10 years ago, a group of scientists in Taiwan created glowing fish. These are the zebra fish with the gene of the medusa, the glowing medusa. And they come in 5 colors. You can buy them on the internet, they cost $5. These are glowing zebra fish in purple, yellow, green, beautiful colors, glowing all the time, these fish. Based on this idea, one of the students of Singularity University decided to create glowing plants. He was a student in 2011 at Singularity University, Anthony Evans. And he actually financed his campaign with Kickstarter. I don't know how many of you know about Kickstarter, but this is financing projects through internet. They put a project and see how many people are interested in the product. And he was looking for $65,000. $65,000, he thought he needed to develop the first glowing plants. 1 week later, he had over $300,000. And at the end of 1 month, he had $500,000. He did not expect that this was going to be so successful. But anyway, his glowing plants were not any type of plants. He was working with marijuana. And you know, marijuana is very popular in California. Especially if it grows. So, but this is serious, and this is one of my students from Singularity University working on that. If you want to see what the professors do at Singularity University, this is one of the professors. He's from Harvard. His name is George Church, and he is working on the extinction. He was in the news about 3 weeks ago because he has implanted the first genome of a holy mammoth into an elephant. We might have, by next summer, the first mammoth back to honor. You know, mammoths died about 5,000 years ago, but there are hundreds of mammoths frozen in Siberia and in northern Canada. There are many, many mammoths frozen. And this scientist, he reconstructed the DNA, the genome, the chromosomes of a mammoth and put it into an elephant. This is like Jurassic Park. But this is for real. This is for real. This is not Jurassic Park in science fiction. Well, there is a big difference. Jurassic Park today is not possible because dinosaurs died 65 million years ago. And for what we know today, the genome can only be reconstructed up to maybe 50,000 years, not 65 million years, with today's technology. Okay, maybe in 20 years it will be possible, but today it's not possible. What is possible is to bring the mammoths back to life. And in Russia, they just opened a few years ago Pleistocene Park, not Jurassic Park. The Jurassic period was the time of the dinosaurs, 65 million years ago. But Pleistocene, because the Pleistocene is when the mammoths lived about between 10 and 20,000 years ago. And this is in northern Siberia, if you want to go and see the first mammoths fairly soon. Okay, many things are happening, also cloning. We will be using cloning a lot in the next 10 years. But we will be using cloning for medical reasons, for therapeutic reasons. If you need a new heart, if you need a new finger, if you need a new eye, you will be able to clone your body parts. Cloning will probably not be used for reproduction. Some people are worried about the clones. But that is not very likely, because for reproduction, it is more entertaining the traditional system, not the cloning system. But this is real. We would have cloning for organs. And one country that is doing a lot is India. I visited a cloning center in India, which is fascinating because in India they have different gods, different religions, different beliefs, and they believe in immortality, and they believe in rebirth. And what is the closest biological thing to Indian rebirth is cloning. Also, the Indian gods are very strange to us, not to them, but to us they look strange, like Ganesh. Ganesh, which is the most popular god, because he's the god of prosperity, and sometimes has three heads. Or Nataraj, that has eight arms. Imagine if you could have three heads and eight arms, you would be divine in India. Not only that, it would be very useful to have three heads. Imagine having three heads at the same time. One head is working, the other head is having fun, and the third head is sleeping, all at the same time. Okay, this is possible. I'm saying this not so that you laugh, because I repeat, this is a serious presentation. But Indians believe in this. So I don't care about what you believe in Bulgaria, to tell you the truth. Because there are 1.4 billion Indians, and they believe in this. So let me show you two numbers. This is the first number I want you to memorize, which is the complexity of the human hardware. And then I will show you the complexity of the human software. The complexity of the human hardware is made by our genome, what makes us physically, biologically. The genome is very different in different species. The virus is the simplest form of life, and the virus were made artificially in the year 2000. There was a scientist that created an artificial virus, but a virus is very small, relatively speaking, only a few hundred genes and a few hundred thousand base pairs of nucleotides. I don't know if you remember biology, there are four nucleotides. A that goes with T and C that goes with G. This is the code of biology. In computer science, there are only two digits, zeros and ones. But in biology, it is four, A, T, C, G. Anyway, a virus was created artificially in the year 2000. A bacteria, which is more complex, was created 5 years ago. One of the invited faculty at Singularity University, Craig Venter, he created an artificial bacteria in the year 2010. And to prove that he created the bacteria, he wrote in the genome his email. This is the first bacteria that has email. It has no father bacteria, no mother bacteria, but has email. This was done 5 years ago. How long do you think it will take before we reach the complexity of the human hardware? Humans, we have 3 gigabytes of information. If you remember, I showed you this pen drive, which has 128 gigabytes. 128 gigabytes. The human genome is 3 gigabytes. How many humans can it fit here? So 128 gigabytes divided by 3 gigabytes, that gives 42.66666. Here, oh, by the way, I have always bad jokes, and I like to offend everybody. So if I have not offended someone at the end, please tell me to offend yourself personally. So, because this is a very bad joke now for me. So here I can fit 42.6. I can put the genome of 42 Bulgarians and 1 little Macedonian. No, it's a bad joke, sorry. I hope I didn't offend too many people. Okay, now let me talk about the complexity of the human software. Human software. As I was mentioning, according to Moore's law, we are going to reach the complexity first of a mouse brain in the next 10 years, then of a monkey brain, and then of a human brain between 20 and 30 years. And everything will be interconnected. We are coming out soon with the 5th generation of telecommunications that will basically connect everything. And they will have also very advanced devices like holographic projections and other things. In this world, people will already be born connected to internet. And the first thing that they will have is more broadband. They need wider broadband. So everything will be connected to everything. We will connect our brains into what is called the Internet of Things, or as Cisco calls, the Internet of Everything. The Internet of Things or the Internet of Everything. Everything will be connected with everything in the next 5 years. BMW announced that by 2025, all of their cars, all of them, will be fully self-driving cars. This is coming, and those cars are going to be connected to humans and to the other cars. Everything will be connected to everything. If you know, Google has the self-driving cars, and the latest prototype, which I just saw 2 months ago in California, it's really beautiful. This is the prototype, the 3rd prototype of the Google self-driving cars. But I don't know if you can see, there is no driving wheel. These cars are a complete change of paradigm. There is no driving wheel. And then when I went inside, you know, it is even scarier because there is no brake, there is no accelerator, there is nothing inside. It is basically a computer on 4 wheels. You are not only part of the first human immortal generation, you are also part of the last human generation that drives. And that is actually very fortunate, because humans, we drive very badly. So everything will be connected to everything, and there will be advanced devices, not like Google Glass, but really advanced devices that will allow us to connect our eyes and our brains to internet, to the cloud, where we will have augmented reality and virtual reality in 2 directions, from the world to our brain, and from our brain to the world. Google announced in 2013, 2 years ago, that they would provide free internet to the whole planet in 2020. This was incredible when they announced that 2 years ago. Unfortunately, they were wrong, and they just announced that it's not going to be in 2020. It's going to be in 2017. In 2017. So that you see how fast this is happening. This was unthinkable 2 years ago. Unthinkable that by 2020 we would have free internet in the planet. Now, it is even closer. And for the whole planet, they are working with balloons. They are working with balloons, and they are already providing this service in New Zealand and in northern Brazil. So soon they will be expanding it worldwide in the next 2 years, working with balloons. But other companies are working with other systems, like Facebook. Facebook also announced, right after Google, that they were working with drones. Not balloons, but drones. And that also, by 2020, they would provide free internet to the world. Mark Zuckerberg also apologized, because he said, actually, next year, India will have free internet with Facebook. So it's not even 2017. Now it is 2016. And there are other companies working with other technologies. There are three companies working with microsatellites. This is one of the companies, which is was founded by young students a few years ago. And they plan also by 2020 to provide free internet with microsatellites. Just a few months ago, two more companies announced that they are working with microsatellites. One is called SpaceX, and the other one is called Virgin Galactic. Richard Branson announced that also in 2 years, they would be able to provide internet with microsatellites to the whole planet. Everywhere in the planet. In the South Pole, so that the penguins have internet. In the middle of the Pacific Ocean, so that the sharks have internet. Everybody, anywhere, all the time, free internet, fast, broadband, continuously. This is going to change the world. This will radically change the world, and there are many companies working on that. So I don't know if it is the microsatellites, or if it is the drones with Facebook, or the balloons with Google, but I know that in 2 years, we will have free internet in the cloud. And artificial intelligence keeps advancing. There is a very popular game on US TV called Jeopardy. Jeopardy is a game of knowledge, to know how much you know. But it's very complicated because it also has music, it has ironies, it has jokes. Jokes, and good jokes, not like my bad jokes. And people said before that computers would never understand music, would never understand irony, would never understand jokes. And in 2011, Watson beat the two human experts in the game. And they were not just any humans. This guy, Ken, had won over $6 million. He was the number one expert in Jeopardy in the world. He had even written a book. He wrote a book about how to win the TV show of Jeopardy. And do you know what Watson did? The computer Watson by IBM, it read the book. It read the book. Well, it not only read the book, it read many books. Watson was born with Wikipedia pre-installed in its memory. How many of you have Wikipedia installed in your brains? How many of you know or remember 1% of 1% of what you have read, or seen, or heard? Well, Watson knows it all, doesn't forget, has a perfect memory, and is very fast finding the information. Anyway, so this was a very expensive computer. It was over $40 million, and it took 4 years to build. But you know what? In 5 years, it will be free. You will have access to Watson and similar devices for free. If you don't believe it, you might remember Garry Kasparov, who was the last human who could still beat a computer. And that happened a long time ago. in 1997. Also before 1997, people didn't expect that computers would beat humans. But now, since 1997, Deep Blue, developed by IBM, beat Gary Kasparov. That was a very expensive computer. It cost over $100 million, more than Watson, because our technology was very primitive at that time, very primitive. 20 years ago, it's prehistoric times today. So it cost over $100 million. Do you know how much it costs today? It is free, and you can download it from internet. This is one of the many computer programs that play chess. This one has 9 levels of difficulty. The top 5 levels are only for computers, the difficult levels. Then the simple levels are for humans. Normal human, caca human, giga human, etc. And this is free, even though it costs $100 million to develop that software at the beginning. So this is coming very fast, and then we get to the most interesting technology, the last technology, cognitive science, cognitive technology. Brain is the most complex organ in the human body, and it's the only organ that we have not been able to replicate, to recreate artificially. Now we have artificial heart, artificial bones, artificial eyes, artificial blood, kidneys, heart, almost anything, except for brains. Why? Because the brain is the most complex organ. Not only that, the brain is the most complex structure in the known universe. There is nothing that we know today that is as complex as the human brain. Nothing. Maybe tomorrow some Martians will arrive and they have bigger brains. But until those Martians come, nothing that we know of in the universe is as complex as the brain. So the brain really is the ultimate frontier, the final frontier. We need to understand the brain, which is the most complex structure in the known universe today. And we will in the next 10 to 20 years. There are many projects to understand the brain since the 1970s, since we understood how the brain evolved. The brain evolved through different animals. The brains appeared with fish. Plants have no brains. Does anyone know what is the function of the brain? The function of the brain is to move. To move, movements are very complex. That is the function of the brain, to coordinate the movements. Because plants do not move, plants have no brains. So the purpose of the brain is not to be intelligent, as you might think. The purpose of the brain is to move. That is the real function of the brain. To be intelligent is probably a very small percentage of what the brain does. Anyway, so brains appear with fish and some other lower class organisms, and they keep on evolving from the reptilian brain, the limbic brain, and the neocortex. We are very similar to a mouse, genetically. If you remember the gene chip, all of you will sequence your genome in the next 5 to 10 years. And if you sequence the genome of a mouse, you will see that we are 90% equal to a mouse. 90%. And if you sequence a chimpanzee, you will discover that we are 99% equal to a chimpanzee. So if someone calls you monkey, then you say, and you too, you are also a gorilla. We are all monkeys here. We are just evolved monkeys, 1%, 2% more than a gorilla. So let me ask you, if we are 1% above a chimpanzee, can you imagine 1% above us? Can you imagine that? If we are 10% above a mouse, can you think 10% above us? I hope you begin thinking about that tonight, because this is what we are going to see in 20 to 30 years. We are going to see the end of the human age. The end of the human age in 20 to 30 years, and the beginning of the post-human age of enhanced humans. That's so that you do not sleep tonight. In Japan, they had this program that by 2018, they would be able to create artificial brains. They are running a bit late. Now they think it's going to be 2023, 2024. But this is a program of the government of Japan. If you can look at the top, this is the Greek Brain Institute of the government of Japan. And the objective is that now by 2023-24, they will be able to create artificial brains. So, if someone here doesn't have a brain, no problem. Just save some money and go to Tokyo in a few years, and you can buy a new brain, 0 kilometers, totally new. Last year, two other brain projects were announced. One in the European Union, which is called the Human Brain Project, that received 1 billion euros for the next 10 years to understand and to create artificial brains. This project is being led by the École Polytechnique Fédérale de Lausanne in Switzerland. And as I said, they just got 1 billion euros to understand the brain. And also in the USA, President Barack Obama also announced the Brain Project in the USA, which also received $1 billion for the next 10 years. So I do not know if the Japanese will discover how to create artificial brains, or if the Europeans, or if the Americans, or soon the Chinese will announce their project. The Chinese are also working on a brain project. So I don't know who, maybe even the Russians. What I know is that in 10 years, we will be able to create a structure as complex as the human brain. So let me show you the second number that you need to know, which is the complexity of the human software. We saw the complexity of the human hardware, 3 gigabytes, now the complexity of the human software. The brain has 10 to the 11 neurons, which is 100,000 million or 100 billion, okay? 10 to the 11 neuron. We don't have more, we just have that, 10 to the 11. Each neuron has about 1,000 connections, or maybe 2,000, 4,000, in the order of magnitude of 10 to the 14 connections, which are called synapses. That is what we have here in the brain. And the brain computes very slowly. Brains are very, very slow, because they work with big chemical ions, which are very slow moving from one place to another. The brain has 6 major frequencies. You have probably heard of alpha waves, beta waves, gamma waves, mu waves. All those are the brain frequencies, which are very slow. 1 hertz, 10 hertz, 100 hertz revolutions per second. A very fast brain, like my brain, is 1,000 hertz. I have 1 kilohertz brain, or as I call it, 1 kakahertz. I have 1 kakahertz. A computer, a telephone today, any electronic device today works in gigahertz. Any electronic device in gigahertz. Why? Because they work with electrons very fast. And we have very slow chemical ions. So your telephone is millions of times faster than your brain. If you don't believe me, who here can divide 4,325.12 by 657.88? Can you do that? Normally no. But your telephone does it immediately. Why? Because it processes 1 million times faster than you do. The difference is that our brain still has more neurons than your telephone has transistors. But this is going to change in the next 10 years. In the next 10 years, your telephone, your computer, will have your brain power. And this is coming. So anyway, what is the complexity of the human software? Again, it is 10 to the 17 operations per second. That is the complexity of the human brain, which is the most advanced structure in the universe as of today. Not in 20 years, but as of today, that's the maximum. And this is obviously if we don't speak about the soul, the mind, and the spirit. And I love to talk about the soul, the mind, and the spirit, but only after 3 glasses of red wine. This is the biggest brain, 10 to the 17 operations per second, but there are the smaller brains, you know? So you have to be careful about the smaller brains. We are going to be connecting our brains to external devices or internal devices, and we will be able to communicate from brain to brain. Scientists just did some experiments recording what happens in the brain of a mouse when it finds cheese in another brain, and put that in the brain of another mouse. And that other mouse found the cheese at the first time. They are doing this now also with monkeys. This is the beginning of telepathy. We are going to see devices like this. This is a company in Silicon Valley called NeuroSky, and this device is called MindWave. This has an electrode, it's like an electroencephalogram, right? One big electrode that captures what is happening in the frontal lobe of my brain. And then it has a connection for air, and it has a Bluetooth to send to your computer. So this captures what is happening in this part of my brain, and it transfers it to my computer. This is the beginning of telepathy. In 10 to 20 years, we will be communicating from brain to brain. Actually, there are companies now that already have 14 electrodes, like Emotive, and soon companies will have 100 electrodes, 1,000 electrodes, 1 million electrodes, and we will communicate from brain to brain. What we're doing here is very primitive. Talking is a very primitive technology. The speaking is a caca technology. The speaking is very primitive. I have to speak word by word by word, bad joke, word, another joke, word, very slow, very inefficient, very narrow bandwidth. The speaking is narrow bandwidth. Telepathy is broad bandwidth. Everything that I want to tell you is in my brain, but I cannot transfer it to you. Because the speaking is a caca technology, very primitive technology, for very narrow bandwidth. In 20 years, at the latest, this presentation will end in 3 seconds. In 3 seconds. In the first second, I send you all the information, completely. Like computers connect immediately, in seconds. All the information goes from one computer to another computer immediately. In the second second, you will ask anything that you want. And in the third second, we go out and drink the glasses of red wine to talk about the spirit, the soul, and the mind. So this is coming. Telepathy is coming. Advanced communication is coming. And in different languages. I might think in Spanish, and you will hear me in your mind in Bulgarian. And we will connect to the robots. Let me show you the last 15 years of Asimov by Honda. Can you imagine the next 15 years of Asimov? Honda says that in 20 years, they will win the football World Cup. So, in Bulgaria, that's in Rush, you will not win the World Cup. Unless it is a Bulgarian robot team that wins the World Cup. And these robots will be absolutely incredible. They will have a lot of the grids of mobility that we do not have. These robots can turn their heads 360 degrees. No problem. Does anyone want to try here? 360 degrees, turn their head. And these robots will have feelings. They will have feelings. In MIT, my alma mater, at the Massachusetts Institute of Technology Media Lab, there is a group of scientists working on understanding the feelings of robots. And they will have feelings which are going to be superior and different to our feelings. In South Korea, I also teach in South Korea, which is a fascinating country. South Korea, they are working, the Department of South Korea is working on a law to give human rights to robots in 10 years. You heard it well, a law to give human rights to robots. This has been discussed in the parliament in South Korea. I don't know what has been discussed in the parliament in South Korea. But you know what has been discussed in the parliament in South Korea. And these robots will be absolutely incredible. Look at those robots. And for the women, no problem. You will have your fantastic macho robots with the advantage that they will not get tired at night. They would never get tired unless you disconnect them. However, we think that robots are bad, right? Many people think that robots are bad. In fact, the word robot that comes from Czech, from the Czech language, means a slave word. So robots are bad, right? And you see Terminator. You know who is the actor that makes Terminator? Arnold Schwarzenegger from Austria, who became governor of California. I don't know if you know. He was governor of California between 2004 and 2008. No, 2008, he was re-elected until 2012. He was governor of California for 8 years. He gave the opening speech for the inauguration of Singularity University in 2009. And Arnold Schwarzenegger, as the governor of California, or as he's called by people who like him, they call him the governator. The governator, he said, fantastic. Until an institution is created to prepare humanity for the end of humanity. Because the science fiction of today is the science reality of tomorrow. And he finished with his most famous phrase. You know what he said, right? Terminator. I'll be back. And in 3 months, his new movie is out, Terminator 5. So watch it, Terminator 5. It happens in 2029. So it is coming, it is coming. Actually, I'm very happy that I see some of our Singularity University students right from. Why don't you come so that I see you? Because you're very tall. So this is one, right up. Also, we have Theodore, if you stand up. I don't know if we have some other Singularitarians here. Okay, well, if you want to know about Singularity University, you have 2 Bulgarians. We have more Bulgarians, but they just happen to be here. Thank you, Theodore. Thank you. So these Bulgarians have seen the future. So, okay, anyway, so you think robots are bad, right? Because the word robot actually is bad. Even female robots are bad. Even when they have robot sex, they are bad. But are robots good or are robots bad? This depends on where you are from. If you are from the Czech Republic, where robot, the word was invented, you think robots are terrible. Bulgaria is good because of the Czech Republic, but you might think robots are bad. In fact, in Europe, robots are normally bad. Even in Hollywood, robots are bad. But do you know where robots are good? In Japan. Robots are good in Japan. The Japanese believe that robots have a soul. The Japanese believe that robots are better than humans. One of the best-selling books last year in Japan is How to Have Sex with a Robot. Read it. You should read it. I don't know if there is a Bulgarian edition, but it really is fantastic. It's non-stop, and it is clear. So, if you look at Japanese people, robots are good in Japan. The Japanese learn that robots are better than humans and that they help humans. I'll give you an example that you will understand because I know you are afraid of robots. And there will be many questions, I know, at the end about robots killing humans and Terminator. I know those questions will come. But let me tell you, robots are good in Japan, in Korea. So that you understand the concept, I'll compare them robots to dragons. Dragons in Europe are bad. Dragons throw fire, dragons eat people, dragons destroy cities. Do you know where dragons are good? In Asia. Dragons are so good that they are the symbol of the Emperor of Japan and the symbol of the Emperor of China. And the best year is the year of the dragon. So, just like you think dragons are bad, if you go to Asia, dragons are good. So if you think robots are bad, well, if you go to Japan, you will discover that robots are good. They are better than you are. So all Japanese companies, okay, again, remember, AI, artificial intelligence, is not the problem. The problem is audio visual. Okay, so all companies are making robots in Japan, and in Korea, and too in China. But this is not humans versus machines. This is not humans versus robots. This is humans and machines. Humans combined with robots. You probably saw the first human cyborg in the Olympic Games in London in 2004. You might have seen, too, last year, the opening ceremony of the Football World Cup in Brazil, where 8 paraplegics connected to mind readers like this, well, more sophisticated, with 100 electrodes, and an exoskeleton. They were paraplegic like that, and then they thought, they stand up, they stood up, they walked, and they kicked the ball to open the World Cup in Brazil. This was done by Brazilians, not by Japanese. And next year, we are going to see the most incredible Olympic Games, which are not the ones in Rio, Brazil. The most incredible Olympic Games will be in Switzerland. The first cyborg Olympic Games of humans who are missing legs, hands, eyes, ears, but are enhanced with technology. The first cyborg Olympic Games will be in Switzerland in October 2016. And if you don't think that is incredible enough, in 2020, we will see the first real robot Olympic Games in Tokyo. The Prime Minister of Japan announced that after the human Olympic Games, which are boring, we will have the robot Olympic Games, which are exciting. The first robot Olympic Games in Tokyo. So, all of this is called philosophically transhumanism. Transhumanism is a philosophy based on humanism, but with science and technology to transcend human limitations. Humans, we have many limitations. We have linguistic limitations, we have physical limitations, we have chemical limitations, we have sexual limitations, we have religious limitations, we have all kinds of limitations. But science and technology will help us transcend those limitations. Because humans, we are not the end of evolution. We are still evolving biologically. But now we can do it with science and technology very fast. With science and technology, we can evolve in days. But we have to do it carefully. We don't want to finish like that. Okay, in the next 10, 20, 30 years, we are going to cure all diseases. Actually better, we are going to prevent all diseases. I believe that in 5 to 10 years, there will be no more paraplegics. This is one of the easiest diseases to fix now, that we know how stem cells work. And in China, they hope to have a cure for paraplegics in 2 to 3 years in China. There will be no paraplegics very soon. We will not have these horrible diseases. We will not have Parkinson's in 20 years at the latest. We will have no Alzheimer's. We will have no cancer. And we will have no aging in 20 to 30 years. We are going to see the death of death in the next 20 to 30 years. But everything has a dark side, the dark side of the force. As the Chinese say, everything has yin yang. And this is so complex that if you look on the right, the yin-yang inside has little yin-yang. And inside that has little yin-yang. So this is a very complex issue because technology can be used for good or for bad. And as the Chinese say, let's light up the world. My objective is not to blame darkness, as the Chinese say. My objective is to light up a candle, to light up a candle. So we can illuminate the world. And you can see this is the famous NASA picture of the world at night. And if you look at South Korea, which is a country I love too, look at South Korea and look at the close-up. There are actually two Koreas. That is why South Korea seems like an island. Because there is the advanced South Korea with the best internet in the world today. The fastest internet in the planet is South Korea. And the only country in the world that still has no internet is North Korea. And they are the same Koreans. But in South Korea, they move into science and technology under a free market system. And in North Korea, they live in the 18th century. There is, in fact, no electricity. And that is why you see no lights. And that is also why there is no internet, because there is no electricity. You know, every day, I was in North Korea about a few months ago. It really is incredible. The light stops every day at least 4 times. It really is incredible. So I thought that Bulgaria doesn't move the way of North Korea. I thought that Bulgaria moves the way of South Korea. Because the world is one, and we have to meditate. I do a lot of meditation with my Hindu friends, my Buddhist friends, also Christian friends. And I finished with this work in Chinese. I lived 3 years in Japan, so I have learned many Chinese characters. And this is a beautiful work in Chinese, Japanese, and Korean, and Vietnamese also. This is the word in Chinese that means crisis. Crisis has two characters. And they are very complicated to draw, as you can see. Before, I draw it upside down or sideways. Now I know this and draw like that. And the word crisis in Chinese, Japanese, Korean, Vietnamese has two characters. The first one is danger, danger. But the second one is opportunity. So humanity is facing the greatest crisis in history. And there is danger, but there is a huge opportunity. So thank you very much.
Много хора преди години и половина ми се смееха да ти не можеш да направиш невроекономика в България, не можеш да направиш функционално изследване с ядрен магнитен резонанс на мозъка, да разбереш какво става в ситуация на риски неопределеност, това че става. А вие сте още по-добри, ще сте по-мали и сте по-умни. Така, сега въпросът тук, просто идвате микрофон. Заповядайте.
Добър вечер. Тъй като има хора, които работят по това хората да станат безсмъртни, работи ли се по въпроса да се осигури за всички хора, тъй като ще стават все повече и повече място за живот, храна и всичко, което имат да нуждат? Тъй като в момента поколение за нещо става.
Yeah, this is a very, very difficult question. Do you understand English? because I'm going to ask you a question here. Do you think there is overpopulation, that there are too many people already in the planet?
Yes, I just think so.
Okay, you know, this is a typical question. So I have 10 different answers. I'll begin with the most ironic joke, and you have seen it already. So I ask people like her, who believe that there are too many people. Well, if there are too many people, you need to begin giving an example and suicide yourself. You are extra. We don't need you if there are too many people. So for people who believe that there are too many, if you are truly ethical with yourself and with your beliefs, kill yourself. But don't worry, you do not have to kill yourself. Okay, that wasn't funny. Now I'll give another answer. So let me explain to you. Actually, I was saying that the human brain is the most complex structure in the universe. Therefore, do you want to have more brains or less brains? You know, our brain doesn't only come with a mouth to eat. It comes with the ability to create, and we can create much more than we consume. Also, planet Earth is nothing in the universe. We live in a small planet, in a small solar system, in a small galaxy, in a huge, unlimited universe. So there are infinite resources in the universe. So it is not true that there are too many people. Also, let me tell you, I lived 3 years in Japan. During those 3 years, the population of Japan went down 500,000 people. The population of the advanced nations is declining, and the population of the emerging nations is stabilizing. The population of the planet is going to hit a top of about 9 billion people in about 2050, and then it will decline. China is the largest tragedy we are going to see in the world. China, in the year 2030, will probably have 1.5 billion people, and then by 2050, the population will decrease 200 million people. China is going to lose 200 million people. That is 30 Bulgarians that are going to disappear. If these trends continue, actually, Japan will disappear also in 100 years. There will be no Japanese in 100 years. Japan will be totally empty in 100 years. So, if you also think that there are too many people here, go to Japan. Or go to Mars. We are going to begin the first Mars exploration missions in the next 15 years. So, if you think there are too many people on Earth, go to Mars, which is totally empty now. Okay, well, there are many ways to explain this paradox, but no, there are not too many people. We need more people because the brain is the most advanced structure in the known universe. Therefore, you want more brains, not less brains. Okay, other questions? Where is the other microphone? Because you have two.
Okay. So I have a question. There are a lot of people in the world with very rigid beliefs, very religious beliefs, and probably for them, as it's about a belief, they just don't think that technology is good, and you give very good arguments about why technology is actually good, but what's the plan to basically convince more people in the world about that technology is good?
Yeah, actually I'm a bit worried about religion, because many religions have been against science many times. As you probably know, Galileo was almost burned by the Catholics in Italy. Or Darwin was also offended a lot in England when he said that we come from monkeys. And the Anglicans, the Christian Anglicans, they said that the Anglicans could not come from a monkey. Maybe Darwin, because it was a mistake, but not the other Greeks. So we are going to see incredible changes, and religion will oppose some of these changes. And I am particularly worried, you know, about monotheistic religions. Because monotheistic religions believe that they have one God, and their God is the right God. And this is very dangerous, because it will stop many ideas on science advancing. So I'm really concerned about, I don't want to offend people here, but I'm very worried about Christianity and about Islam because of these monotheistic beliefs, which are very primitive. Our religions are very new. The religions of the pharaohs of Egypt lasted 3,000 years. 3,000 years, twice as long as Islam. And 50% more than Christianity. And today we call that religion, or the religion of the Greeks that lasted 2,000 years, we call it mythology. I believe that in 50 years we will call Christianity and Islam a mythology. Especially because we will go from planet Earth to other planets. And we are going to remember the times when we were primitive societies and we had these stupid gods. I don't want to offend the God, but anyway, religion is a big problem. And again, I'm worried about that because religious restrictions have stopped science many times. And there are many religious groups opposed totally to science and technology. You might know about the Amish. The Amish in Pennsylvania, they don't take any science and technology for the last 2 centuries, which I think is really stupid. Because they took the technological advances until the 18th century, but nothing after that. Okay? So anyway, this is a very complicated thing, and you know, you should never talk about politics and never talk about religion. So I just talked about those two.
Здравейте! Аз искам да продължа да отправя тук малко на много психология, казвам още много песимизъм. Искам чисто да описвам, да попитам за технологичната теза. Това е термин, който въведоха при около 30 години от Световната банка и някаква такава институция. И как се вписва това разбиране в вашата лекция? Технологичната теза казва, че технологично развитите държави ще развиват по-бързо, технологично неразвитите държави се развиват по-малко. И затова има толкова борби около авторски права. Мики Маус е много по-лос пример, защото Мики Маус е първото нещо, което е послужило за увеличаване на свободата.
Okay, let me finish up with the previous point about religion, because many religions, monotheistic religions, stop many advances because they say they know the truth. That is why I would like to invite you to go to Asia to know more about Hinduism and Buddhism. Because in Hinduism and Buddhism, they already believe that life is immortal, that we are immortal. And that depending on our life, we evolve higher or lower. If you behave well, you go and you reincarnate into something superior. If you behave badly, you reincarnate into something inferior. So East Asian and South Asian religions are really fascinating because they believe that we are evolving and we can evolve into something greater, that we are not the end of evolution, we are not created to the image of God, we keep on changing. So we're talking about technology and this technological ability for what I understood. Well, technology first is what makes us different from animals. Animals really don't have technology. This is what makes us human, the technology, and that we incorporate technology into us. Now, in terms of this difference of technology between advanced countries and emerging countries, I think the gap is narrowing. The difference is actually narrowing. Like I mentioned, this thing which cost $1 billion at the beginning and cost and took 13 years, it would be $10 one minute. Everybody, everywhere will have access to this. There will be no gap between advanced and advancing developing nations. In fact, that is why having free internet for the whole planet in 2 years is so important. Because there will be no limits to knowledge. Everybody will have access to the same knowledge everywhere in the planet. In fact, even the expression, I do not know, will not exist in 5 years. Because if you want to know something, you will be able to know immediately. So there will be no technological divide. Technology, when it begins, It's expensive and it is bad when technology first appears. Then when it massifies, it becomes cheap and everybody has it. So with the massification of technology, it goes from being expensive and bad to cheap and good. So I think this is what is going to help all of humanity. But the problem is not technology. The problem, I think, is the human mind and this religion, this monotheistic belief that some people have, that think that we are the end of evolution. We are not the end of evolution. And I want to put this very clearly to you, and I hope you are not offended. If you think this is the end, maybe that's the Bulgarian way. But if you go to Japan, if you go to Korea, you will see we are not the end. We are just the beginning of conscious evolution. We are just the beginning of a new world coming up. So I just want to help to open up your minds. As I said, I don't want to blame darkness. I just want to light up a candle. So I hope I'm trying to bring you ideas of what is happening in India, what is happening in Japan, what is happening in Korea, where robots are better than humans.
Thank you for the lecture, it was really interesting. I want to ask you a little bit about the not so far further future. Like in the long run, I see the things are going pretty good, to be immortal, but what do you think are the biggest risks in the shorter period of time? Because if you have like $60,000 to make a glowing plant, how much do you need to make a deadly virus, which is the most simple or better theory? So, how is it?
Well, I just explained it. This is going to cost $10. You know, technology is going to be incredibly cheap. And to make us live longer, it's going to be very cheap. I'm going to try to explain to you in physical terms, in the simplest terms. You know that you are 70% water, right? All of us are 70% water. Maybe some people are more watery than others, but on average, we are 70% water. And we are not Perrier water, Evian water, no. We are tap water. You know, we are dirty water. The other 30% that makes us is very simple chemical elements. It's mostly carbon, sodium, potassium, nitrogen. You don't cost $100 in chemical elements. That is what you cost, less than $100. And don't take it personally. I don't cost $100 either. Even a fat person, they don't cost more than $100 because they are mostly water anyway. So to make a human is very cheap. You are so cheap that you were made one night by your parents and they didn't spend probably $100 to make you. What I want to try to explain that your atoms are very simple. You are a few atoms of carbon, hydrogen, oxygen, and other things. We can make you, we can replicate you very cheaply. We can keep you alive in good shape very cheaply, and this will happen thanks to nanotechnology in 20 years. Every part of you can be enhanced, can be maintained, can be replicated very cheaply, because we are cheap. We are really made of dust and a bit of water. Well, you see, we live in the most incredible times in human history. And wait, because in 2 years we are going to have internet. The whole planet, we are going to be connected completely to internet. Things are only going to get more and more exciting, and things are going to get cheaper and cheaper and cheaper. So in every technology, in computers, in biotechnology, soon, as I explained, in nanotechnology. Nanotechnology is running about 20 years behind biotechnology. So all of these things are going to change the world so much. For example, with nanotechnology, you will be able to produce a kilogram or a liter of anything for under $1. A kilogram of anything. If you want to eat a kilogram of caviar, it will cost less than $1. Because it is only how the atoms are arranged. You will drink a liter of champagne for less than $1. It is only how we arrange the atoms that make the champagne or that make the caviar. And we are going to have that technology in 20 years with nanotechnology. So things are only going to get cheaper, faster for the whole planet.
Just a few days ago, it was announced that a new study found that Bulgaria is the country with the fastest internet in the world before South Korea. Just inform me. But another study has also found out that one out of five jobs will be stolen by software or by hardware in the near 10 to 20 years. So how do we keep software and also hardware from stealing our jobs?
Okay. First of all, it's very good what you're saying that the internet in Bulgaria has improved so much. That's fantastic. And in other countries, it will become faster because the technology every time is better. So when North Korea eventually, in the next 5 to 10 years, I forecast that the government of North Korea is non-viable. In less than 10 years. North Korea will collapse thanks to all the advances in technology. And then they will go from having no internet to having the very best internet, much better than the one in Bulgaria. Just to give you an example, because every country, you know, is at the top for a few weeks, a few days maybe, and then another country comes up. But anyway, at this time, it is true. I actually knew it, and I am happy that you checked it. You know, this is something I cannot say in California. In California, you cannot make mistakes because all the students are checking what you are saying real time. You know, this is terrible for professors. You cannot make mistakes anymore. You cannot lie anymore. You cannot tell too many bad jokes anymore because they can check immediately what you are saying. So, had I known that some people would check some of the things I said, I would have been a little bit more careful. But anyway, so thank you about that. About the jobs, only one out of every five jobs is going to be taken by robots. Only one. I would like all the jobs to be taken by robots and artificial intelligence. In fact, there is a movement towards that because everything that we do today can be done by an artificial intelligence with a robotic body. Everything, there is almost nothing that we do today that cannot be done by an artificial intelligence that will reach human intelligence between 2029 and 2045. So basically everything can be done by artificial intelligence. But again, you actually do not have to worry about them because we are creating this artificial intelligence with us, for us. These artificial intelligence are going to be merged with us. They are part of what is called the human-machine civilization. Let me give you an example with my glasses. This is a technology that I have incorporated into me. We are going to be incorporating more and more technology inside ourselves. And this technology will be part of us. The connection we will have to internet from our brains will be a continuous connection to internet, to the cloud, to the global cloud. So this is not that we have an invasion of robots from Mars. No, we are creating this technology for us, with us. But it's a very good point what you are making. However, remember, what we are going to see is much more incredible than that. Much more incredible than that. And I want to say again so that you do not sleep tonight. We are going to see the end of the human age. Anything that you know, anything that you believe today will be not applicable in 30 years. Let me explain to you why. Your telephone computes a million times faster than your brain. A million times faster. As I said before, the difference is that you still have more neurons than your telephone has sensors. But this will change. This will change soon. And once we enhance our brains with this technology, our brains will be millions of times faster than they are today. Millions of times. So in 1 second, once you enhance your brain, in 1 second, you will experience all your life. All of a normal life would be experienced in 1 second of an augmented intelligence. This is so, so radical that, to give you another example, when was the last time that you talked to a little ant? Do you talk to ants in the street when you see an ant? We don't talk to ants, right? Because there is no communication possible between ants and ants. In the future, when we enhance our brains millions of times, millions and then billions, there will be no communication possible between a normal human, to put it that way, normal or a standard human, and an enhanced post-human. So I hope you don't sleep tonight.
You said that in 20, 30 years, technology will be able to predict our diseases. We can imagine our child. What happens when we can predict everything? Isn't life going to come a little bit vague, knowing that, for me, expectancy, when I expect something, that is the period that I'm most excited, but most terrified. For example, my father, he was terrified if I'm going to be a smart, intelligent man or a violent criminal, or where you're going to be in the next 3 months. Isn't that going to terrify like half of the population and just kill the joy of life?
Well, again, if you are terrified, if you are scared, you can always die. I mean, you don't have to live forever. I mean, this is a decision. If you are bored or if you are scared, you can finish your own life. But I think the future is so absolutely incredible. However, you know, some of these questions I cannot really answer, and no one can answer them, because we do not know what will happen after the technological singularity. We do not know. We cannot even imagine what will happen once we have an intelligence which is superior to a normal intelligence today. No one knows. That is why it is called the singularity, because it's impossible to see beyond that point. So I don't make any forecast after 2045, which is the late year of the singularity, which I believe it will happen, because all the trends are that way, and because I always go to Japan and Korea, and I see these things happening, and they want it. They want it in Japan and Korea, also because their populations are declining already. So not only do they want to live longer, because also they believe in rebirth, and that they believe they can be superior to what they are today. They want to be superior, because we have the technology to become post-humans, to go beyond the human condition today. So I do not know what is going to happen. No one knows what is going to happen. Probably we will create a global brain, and we will interconnect all of us. Or maybe some part of civilization will go to Mars and other planets, and we will start the colonization of the universe. Really, no one knows. So I do not know what is going to happen after 2045, and before that time, it's not the end of the world either. So nothing is going to, I think, hopefully destroy humanity before that time. And it could be only us. So the danger is not the technology, it's the humans. I am not worried about artificial intelligence. I am worried about human stupidity. That is what worries me.
Yeah, just a last small question. Yeah, actually, my name is Andre. I work in a company. We actually produce some robots here in Sofia. And it seems that you believe in robots more than in a human being. So, a really short question. And really personal question. Are you sorry that you are not a robot?
Well, I think we are going to keep on evolving. I want to evolve. I want to go to other planets. I think we are going to discover incredible things in the future. We are going to see magic. So our bodies are very limited. Our bodies are not going to go to Mars. Our biological bodies have many problems. They are not good for space travel. If we had robotic cars, then we could change them. But anyway, I'm not upset. This is the way we are. But I think we will continue to evolve. And I want to see that future. I think we are going to discover incredible things, and not just in this planet. So I want to see that. I think we live in the most incredible times of human history. Nothing like this has ever been achievable before. So I want to see that future. I think we have an incredible potential for humanity and post-humanity. And I'm looking forward to that, and I hope you are too, because we truly live in the most incredible times in human history. So thank you very much.
Приятна вечер и не застирайте бързо, не сте така.